Welkom, dear brothers and sisters, in our Lord Jesus Christ. Today I would like to speak living under the control of the Holy Spirit. Be full of the Holy Spirit. I often preach about that in my sermons. So, what are the conditions how to be full of the Holy Spirit? Let us start in 1 Thessalonians 4. Finally, brethren, we beseech you and exhort you in the Lord Jesus, that as you learn from us how you ought to live and to please God, just as you are doing, you do so more and more. For you know what instructions we gave you through the Lord Jesus. For this is the will of God, your sanctification, that you abstain from immorality, that each one of you know how to take a wife for himself in holiness and honor, not in the passion of just like heathen who do not know God, that no man transgress and wrong in his brother in this matter, because the Lord is an avenger in all these things, as we solemnly forward you, for God has not called us for uncleanness, but in holiness. Therefore, whoever discard this, discard not man, but God, who gave his Holy Spirit to you. We are called to holiness. Look, today I am dressed in white. It is winter here in Brazil, about 25 degrees Celsius, so it is possible to dress. Holiness, pureness, the Holy Spirit, the white dove, the symbol calling us to be clean. We are in the world, but we do not need to participate in the sins of the world, rejecting God. We are called to be living witnesses in our daily life of our Lord Jesus Christ. Why? Because with the Holy Spirit, as soon as you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior, you get the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. That Holy Spirit is very necessary. Why is that very necessary? Because let us look at Luke 11, the verses 26. Then that evil spirit goes and brings seven other spirits more evil than himself, and they enter and dwell there, and the last state of that man becomes worse than the first. We are talking here about a person who said, I don't wish you anymore, evil spirit, go out of me, and that person cleaned his house. You can compare that with a person on which evil spirits are exposed pills, a person who was cured from diseases, but the person did not accept Jesus Christ as Savior. He was cleaned of demons, cured from a disease, but didn't accept Jesus Christ as Savior. This evil spirit was going to the desert. He didn't like to live in the desert, so he said to himself, let me go back to that person. There he found the house cleaned, and he went to 7 more spirits, more worse than himself, and took them, and they started to live in that person. So when we, the person who accept Jesus Christ as his Savior or her Savior, it is necessary that in that person the Holy Spirit goes to indwell. Because then demons and Satan is not capable to live in that person. John 14 verse 16 tells us, and I will pray the Father, I is Jesus, that he will give you another counselor to be with you forever, for eternity. 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 14 tells, guard the truth that has been entrusted to you by the Holy Spirit who dwells within us. 1 Corinthians 6 verse 19, do you not know your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, which you have from God? 2 Corinthians 1 verse 22, he has put his seal upon you and gave us his Holy Spirit in our hearts as a guarantee. Ephesians 1, the verses 13 to 14, sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, which is the guarantee of your inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of his glory. The Holy Spirit is our seal that we shall have eternal life. Eternal life where it depends upon you. If you will let Jesus Christ reign and control your life, you accept Jesus Christ as Lord, you will be taken at the rapture of the church and go to heaven. But in my opinion, Matthew 24, the verse 41, also tells that Christians will be not taken and will be left. So that means, according to me, that those Christians are sealed by the Holy Spirit. However, they will pass to the Great Tribulation. If they remain faithful and not accept the mark of the beast, they will have eternal life on the new earth, because they are sealed with the Holy Spirit. So let us go back, brothers and sisters, about the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. We know to go to Genesis, to creation, Eden and Eve, they sinned, and it was promised, if you eat from the forbidden fruit, you will certainly die. When they eat those forbidden fruit, sin entered, and the Holy Spirit, the Spirit with which they could communicate with God, was taken. Remember, human is created in the image of God, the Trinity, God the Father, Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. Human, spirit, soul and body, the Trinity. The Trinity was broken. The Holy Spirit, the spirit of man was taken. And no wonder that nowadays, and from that age on, they are missing something in their life. They are missing the spirit. They are seeking because they are missing something. Persons are seeking in yoga, in Buddhism, Islam. They need that spirit, but only the Holy Spirit is through Jesus Christ. In the whole Old Testament, persons were temporarily filled with the Holy Spirit, who walk in the will of God, who lived a holy life. Only Noah was found clean before God, and he and his family was saved. We have Abraham, but we never read that he was full of the Holy Spirit. We have the prophet, we have King David, but it was only temporary that they received the Holy Spirit. Nowhere we read in the Old Testament that the Holy Spirit took indwelling, because he lives inside them. Even the disciples during the life of Jesus Christ on earth, they didn't receive the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. First, Jesus Christ needed to die on the cross, because without blood shedding there is no forgiveness. And they needed to wait until Pentecost to be filled and receive the Holy Spirit to dwell in them. First, sin had to be taken away, and that only occurred after the blood shedding of Jesus Christ on the cross. So now a person who accepts Jesus Christ, immediately he or she receives the Holy Spirit, who goes to live inside that person to prevent that Satan and demons can take that body. But Ephesians 4 verse 30 is very clear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, in whom you are sealed for the day of redemption. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit by turning you back to God, going to love the things in the world, going to live a sinful life again. John the Baptist and Jesus Christ were very clear. Repent. Turn you back to the world. Turn you back to sin. Repent. And if there is no repentance, you continue to live in the world doing sins, because there are some preachers who they say Jesus Christ died for your sin, so you can continue to sin. This is a big lie. They are false teachers. And 1 Thessalonians 5 verse 19 is even severe. Do not squinch the Spirit. Squinch. Look to Ananias and Sapphira, his wife. They lied. And the result, although they were Christians, they committed the sin to the Holy Spirit and both died. In my opinion, brothers and sisters, but I have no proof, I can't prove that from the Bible, persons who squinch the Holy Spirit, they won't go and won't be taken at the rapture of the church, but hopefully they will go and have eternal life on the new earth. 1 Corinthians 3 verses 1 to 3 says, but I, Paul, brethren, could not address you as spiritual men, but as men of the flesh, as babes in Christ. I feed you with milk, not solid food, for you are not ready for it. And even now you are not ready, for you are still in the flesh. For while there is jealousy and strife among you, you are in the flesh. You are behaving like ordinary men. Those people in Corinthians, they had a lot of dons, but they are living in the flesh, living a sinful life, doing not the will of God. Hebrews 5, verse 12 to 14. For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the first principles of God's word. That sin, that uncleanness, immorality, repentance of sin, the first principles of God's word. You need milk, not solid food. For everyone who lives on milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness. For he is a child, but solid food is for the mature, for those who have their faculty strength by practice to distinguish good from evil. Milk. When a baby is born, he needs the milk from the breast of the mother. But after about 6 months, He don't need to use milk to be fed with milk. He's going slowly to eat solid food. We don't need to stay babies in faith. The young Christian, the babes in Christ, they need to start to feeding with milk. The Word of God, the Bible. Start praying. Be educated by teachers in Christ. They need to grow to the solid food, to be teachers. Are you an adult in faith? Are you a teacher? Are you solid food? Are you feeding your brothers and sisters with our babes in Christ, with the Word of God, teaching them how to pray, for what to pray, for the world, for governments, for brothers and sisters, for Israel, the Jews, the Israelites, and now with all what is going on in Afghanistan. That those Christians will be protected and not be killed. Are you a teacher? Are you an adult in faith? Are you sowing Jesus Christ in your daily life? Does believers and unbelievers see Jesus Christ in your daily life? Without immorality, a holy life, a sinless life. If you are aware of your sin, you confess immediately, not trapped by Satan. Having knowledge, a good knowledge. Distinguish good from evil. Like Jesus Christ with those three temptations when he returned from the desert, quoting the Bible and interpreting the Bible correctly, and he defeated Satan, and Satan had to go away. The example of Jesus, is that showing in your life? Rejecting what is evil, yoga, magnetisme, homeopathia, acupunctura, pilates, homeopathia, okay, what is that? That is, they say, that are medicines, but they are looted so much that it hasn't any effects, but it is a thought under the new moon and demons and Satans. I'm not speaking about natural herbs, which are 7% herbs. They cure. That is given by God. Pilates, don't be deceived. One day I went to a treatment of Pilates, and there I heard the music, and the Holy Spirit told me, Wilfred, listen, that's not of God, that's of evil. And that was my first and last treatment. Not giving an opening to Satan. Be clean, be holy. many vitamins, preparates, there is ginseng. Also, not of God. Investigate on ginseng, what is behind it. Don't use those. And then a lot of things you see nowadays, the name of yoga. Reject it. If you're going to a person who practices magnetism, you will see in their waiting rooms pictures of Jesus, words of the Bible. Oh, you would say, don't be trapped. They are just to trap you in the evil. May I say, brothers and sisters, my mother didn't wish to know about my faith. She practiced in her last years acupuncture. The last year of her life was terrible. A lot of pains. Horrible. And I was there with my family from Brazil. She was dying. The doctors couldn't help her anymore. And the Holy Spirit told me, Wilfred, go to the evangelical bookshop and buy Almere. I was obedient. And in the evening, I applied the miracle, cleaning her in the name of Jesus Christ from the head to the teeth. She was unclean, not holy, not acceptable with that unclean body to be taken by God. And in the morning, she died. Where are you looking? What are you looking in films? Television, internet, Netflix, YouTube. Are you closing your eyes when you see uncleanness, immorality, pornography? What is not pleasing God? When you are watching, Jesus Christ is looking to that. All what Jesus Christ will not look at, you need to remove. What about books you are reading? That's pleasing? Horror films are pleasing Jesus Christ? There's so much evil nowadays in films on the internet. And be aware of souvenirs you take from a foreign country. I went into a Christian home to the toilet. I saw there a Buddha image. And I asked the person, a Christian? Why is there a Buddha image in your toilet? Oh, we took that from our vacation. But that is an idol. That's evil. You are opening, giving an opening to Satan, to demons. Rebecca Brown, she is very clear about what is taken into your home from your holidays. If the Holy Spirit is still in you, destroy it. And some you may clean with mirror oil and clean them in the name of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, He is our Savior and Lord. Our life needs to be holy. I heard some person telling God punish the Jews, the Israelites, with those 6 million persons killed in the Second War. How blind they are! Jesus is the King of the Jews. When He was crucified, what did Pontius Pilatus wrote? A sign above His head on the cross was written, King of the Jews. Jesus died in the first place for the Jews and the Israelites. So let us go to Acts 2, the verses 1 to 4. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly a sound came from heaven like the rush of a mighty wind. And it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared to them tongues as of fire, distributed and rested on each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues, other languages, as the Holy Spirit gave them utterance. If we go to verse 8 and 9, there are about 15 languages spoken by uneducated persons, possible except Matthew, who was a tax collector, they began to speak in languages that could be understood by persons in their country. Other languages, understandable by persons out of that country. I need to be clear. This is a very serious thing. We are talking about the transgression period. The transgression that the Holy Spirit did not dwell in Jews and Israelites in the Old Testament. And now it was, as Jesus had promised in John 14, verse 16, the Holy Spirit was going to dwell into the believer. A sign, a clear sign. A baptism in the Holy Spirit. But that baptism was only once. Look what is written. And a sound came from heaven like the rush of a mighty wind and filled the house, and there appeared on them tongues of fire. That occurred nowadays more times in the New Testament? No! This baptism was accompanied by the sound from heaven, like the rustle of a mighty wind, and tongues setting upon them. That doesn't occur anymore, nor after that event on Pentecost. So don't be mistaken about baptism in the Holy Spirit. Acts 2 verse 38 says, repent, and those people who repented, they were baptized, everyone, in the name of Jesus Christ. Verse 41, 3,000 persons repented and were baptized with tongues of fire? No, they were baptized in water. Baptism signifies in those days baptism in streaming water, in water. First repentance and thereafter the baptism in water. Do not, don't need the baptism in the Holy Spirit. Because the moment you repent, accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you receive immediately the Holy Spirit as a seal, as your counselor. But that 3,000 persons, they were not Gentiles. They were all Jews, all Israelites. So how can you say that those 6 million people killed in the Second War is a punishment of God? Because they said, the blood of Jesus come over us, crucify him. Here was already the proof. 3,000 Jews, Israelites, they repented and were baptized in the water. They received the Holy Spirit. Let's go to Acts 8, verse 38. There we have Philip. He heard the Enoch reading Jesaja. He was from Ethiopia. He was a Jew. Has to be. Many Jews were living in Ethiopia. And a few years ago, the Jews, they were saved. They were taken miraculously by aircrafts from Ethiopia to the state Israel. But this Enoch here in Acts, and he commanded the carrier to stop, and they both went down into the water, Philip and the Enoch, and he baptized him. In water, that Enoch accepted Jesus Christ, but he didn't receive a mighty wind, a tongue of fire. No, this, I think you, because it wasn't given yet to the Gentiles. He was baptized in water. And we need to go to Acts 10 with that vision of Peter, where Peter was ordered to go to the Gentile, to Cornelius and his household. Peter was very willing, but he was ordered. We are in the transition period. For the Jews, only the kingdom of God were for the Jews, for the Israelites, not for the Gentiles. And now Peter proclaimed for the first time the gospel to a Gentile. And after they accepted and believed, the Holy Spirit came upon them. A proof that the Gentiles were also included in the salvation. And they were baptized with tongues. There came a mighty wind from heaven to the household. No, they were baptized in water. So people, Jesus in the first place is the king of the Jews, of the Israelites. And we are participating in that grace of God. So be careful that you do not grieve the Holy Spirit by not praying for the state of Israel, by not praying for the Jews and the Israelites. You need to be clean. If you reject the Jews and the Israelites, you are not pleasing God the Father. That is a severe sin. Be aware of that. So, there are some more things I need to say about the Holy Spirit. 1 Timothy 5, verse 22. Paul is telling to Timotheus, do not be hasty in the laying on of hands, nor participate in another man's sin. Keep yourself pure. Laying on hands is transferring power, sins to another person. Your sins. Paul has laid on the hands, on his head, upon Timotheus. Paul, a witness that Jesus Christ was living in his daily life, showing cleanness, purity. He was called an apostle by Jesus Christ. He kept himself from sin. He was pure, without sin. He could lay on the hands, his hands, on Timotheus, because Timotheus was called to be a great preacher, and another example. And here, in his letter to Timotheus, Paul says, do not be hasty in the laying on of hands. Do not participate in other men's sin. Transference. I heard the story of an African people, of an African man who visited in Rotterdam, the Netherlands, a congress of elders, deacons, preachers, teachers of Sunday school, and other Christians, the person in front preaching there, for a few moments he changed to speaking in tongues. When he completed, all people shouted there, Amen, Amen, Hallelujah! Are you? There was no explanation of what this man spoke. But this African man, he understand, he heard in his African language, this person cursing all the people present and blasphemy God. Be careful when you are speaking tongues without any explanation. In another church, there was a woman with serious problems. She went to the church, and there was a woman speaking there. She said, "With some person here present with serious problems. Do we not all have problems, severe problems?" A general statement. But this woman, she thought, oh, that is a message for me. And after the sermon, she went to this woman. This woman put the hands on and spoke in languages, in tongues. At night, this woman had severe dreams, evil dreams. She shouted, and her husband needed to pray to calm her down. Several nights, this continued, transference of evil, and the elders of the church had to expulse the demons and clean her by the blood of Jesus Christ. I myself will not lay on hands on anyone, except for my family, unless the Holy Spirit will instruct me, but that hasn't occurred until now. I lay on the hands on my sons when they need it, they are sick. I lay on my hands on the parts of the body of my wife which are ill. I lay on my hands on the head of my wife when she has severe headache. And I pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to cure. But remember, man and wife are one. Abraham, he blessed his sons by laying on hands. Don't let preachers, elders, or any believer lay hands upon you, because you don't know the hidden sins of them in their daily life. I heard of preachers practicing immorality, adultery. They transfer that to the people who they laid hands on. Keep clean. If not, you can't be full of the Holy Spirit. And how can you know that the person that you are full of the Holy Spirit? Galatians 5 verse 22 tells, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, and may I add, hospitality, loving your neighbor as yourself, and God in the first place. If you are seeing those fruits of the Holy Spirit, you may say that that person is full of the Holy Spirit. We need to be watchful. Only if we live without immorality, only if we live a holy life to the honor of God and grace of Jesus Christ and God the Father, we are capable of being full of the Holy Spirit, to understand the will of God. And that will never goes against the Bible. If you receive a dream or a message of a prophet, this contradicts the Bible, that's not of God. Don't be misguided, but in order to receive the messages of the Holy Spirit, your life needs to be clean. You need to live a holy life. If not, the fruits of the Holy Spirit will not be completely in you. Full of the Holy Spirit, proclaiming, teacher, being a teacher, an adult in faith, we don't need to stay babes in faith. We need to grow to being teachers, to being adults in faith. That's where the Christian is called to. Being full of the Holy Spirit and living under the control of the Holy Spirit. But there are conditions. Conditions which I hope I have explained in this sermon. Thank you, God the Father and Jesus Christ, that you are very clear that we don't need to live in darkness, but we can live in light. You have truly given us the conditions to be the light, to grow to adults in faith, being examples and testimonies, witnesses in our daily life. Help us to live a sinless life, to repent of our sins, and to be a witness and examples in our daily life. The believers and unbelievers may see Jesus Christ, that we are full of the Holy Spirit by practicing love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control, and so on. Help us, fill us with the Holy Spirit, and do not let us grieve and extinguish the Holy Spirit. We ask you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. I wish to give you the blessing from Ephesians 1 verse 2. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord of Jesus Christ be with you all. Let us be examples of Jesus Christ showing in our daily life. Thank you very much, brothers and sisters.